Storyblocks Audio.
You cannot be living anyhow, and you believe that one day you will die, and then all the bishops in the earth will gather and then conduct a mass for you, do sacrifice for you, pray you into the kingdom of God. That is a philosophy from the pit of hell. How you live here on earth will tell you where you will end in eternity.
Storyblocks Audio.
Marching on in light of God, marching on, I am marching on, of that path that the Master trod, marching, marching on. A robe of white, a crown of gold, I have a home, a mansion fair, a victor's palm, a joy untold, a mine when I get there. Ibubele, marching on through the hosts of sin, marching on, I am marching on. Victory is mine while I've Christ within. Marching, marching on. A robe of white, a crown of gold, I have a home, a mansion fair, a victor's palm, a joy untold, a mine when I get there. Marching on while the skeptics snare, marching on, I am marching on. Perfect love casteth out all fear, marching, marching on. A robe of white, a crown of gold, a home, a mansion fair, a victor's palm, a joy unto a mine when I get there. Shalabadosa. Marching on with the flag on flood, marching on, I am marching on. Preaching Christ to the dying world, marching, marching on. A robe of white, a crown of gold, a harp, a home, a mansion fair, a victor's palm, a joy untold, a mine when I get there. A robe of white, a crown of gold, a home, a mansion fair, a victor's palm, a joy unto a mine when I... Come on, let's sing it one more time right now. A robe of white, a crown of gold, a home, a mansion fair, a victor's palm, a joy unto a mine when I get there. Glory be to Jesus. Father, we thank you so much for another privilege today in your presence. Beautiful day you have made that we should be glad and rejoice in it. Thank you so much. We do pray that you open our eyes to behold wondrous things from the scriptures today. Have your way, mighty God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to read the book of First. I want to welcome every one of you on board today. I believe that the Lord will bless you in a special way. In Jesus' name. Amen. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Grace of God I am, by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Ebubele. Wherever I am today is by the grace of God. This grace that was bestowed upon me, I didn't take for granted. It wasn't in vain. And I labored abundantly. I also did something. I didn't just, leave everything to chance. And then this grace spoke, in my life. Wow. I'll be looking at levels of grace today. Levels of grace today. Some time ago, I did a teaching on exceeding grace. And I took time that time to define grace, saying that grace is an unmerited favor. And I also took time to show you what favor is like. We said favor is what makes God look like a partial God. And I said, Bible said, Esau I hate, Jacob I love. How can you explain that? Is none of him that willeth, nor him that runneth, but of him that showeth mercy. And I say, how can he explain that? And he says, the race is not to the swift, neither the battle to the strong. How can he explain that? So I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. So it simply means that, favor is what God decides to do for somebody. Someone can do all the running, but God will give a reward to whom he wants to give. So that takes care of our defining grace again today. I want to look at levels of grace as believers in Christ. I want to tell you that you have received grace from God. The Bible says that out of the fullness of Christ, we all have received grace. In the book of John, chapter 1, verse 16. Say, out of the fullness of Christ, we have all received grace. So it is by grace that we are saved through faith. That one we know too well from Ephesians chapter 2, from verse 8 to 10. So looking at levels of grace today, I want to show you that number one, we can have what is called frustrated grace. What did I call it? Frustrated grace. What does that mean? It means that number one, grace can be frustrated. If you like, put it this way, grace can be wasted. And that's why Paul said, the grace of God that was bestowed upon me was not in vain. So the grace of God can be poured upon somebody and the person will frustrate it. It will be in vain. It will be of no effect. You didn't allow that grace to bear fruit, to manifest, in your life. So the grace of God can be frustrated. And we have one example here, or two, or even three. One is Esau. The Bible said Esau frustrated the grace of God in his life through sin and being carnally minded. The Bible said he missed out in the grace of God. Hebrews chapter 12 from verse 16, that Esau missed out. Let no man, miss out in the grace of God. Like Esau, Esau missed out in the grace of God. And by the time he sought for that grace with tears, the Bible said, he could not find the grace anymore. Sometimes when we talk about Esau, the only thing that comes to mind is that he sold his birthright. But the book of Hebrews chapter 12, 16 to 17 will tell you that there were about three sins there. Number one was the sin of, immorality. It was there. The sin of bitterness was also there. The sin of profanity was there, three of them. As a matter of fact, it was this selling of Betra was the fourth one. It was the one that was put last. So these were the things happening in his life that frustrated the grace of God. Again, somebody like Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 15, 22 to 23, it frustrated the grace of God with his persistent disobedience. He fed in the grace of God, and that was why Samuel said, hey, sorry, from today the kingdom is taken from you and is given to another person who is better than you. So the grace of God can't be frustrated. And again, somebody like Judas, also frustrated the grace of God. Judas Iscariot, who through greed and covetousness fell out in the grace of God. So the Apostle Paul said in Galatians chapter 2 verse 21, I do not frustrate the grace of God. That's what Paul said, Galatians chapter 2 verse 21. I do not frustrate the grace of God. That is to say that the grace of God can be frustrated. Listen to me, my dear friend. God has given you so much grace to give your life to Him, but you are taking it for granted. You have had situations that would have made you to die, but God saved you, giving you a long rope, giving you opportunity to repent, but you are still procrastinating it. A number of things have happened in your life, and you kept frustrating the grace of God in your life. You better utilize the grace of God now before it is too late, because the grace of God can certainly be frustrated. So that's number one, people who have frustrated the grace of God in their lives. And you know what happens? Such people suffer like those in Romans. Those in Romans chapter 1, the Bible said that they frustrated the grace of God. And so God gave them over to a reprobate mind. One young man, after listening to me on radio, one day called me and said, what is going on? In fact, he came to see me. He said, God gave me opportunities to repent of this particular sin, but I couldn't utilize that opportunity. And now I have done everything to stop it. It's not working out. He asked me, could it be God has handed me over to a reprobate mind? It can happen. God has been warning you about pornography, but you are persistently doing it, warning you against lust, warning you against fornication, or against adultery, against masturbation, against lesbianism, against homosexuality, against those bad habits, smoking, drinking alcohol. And sometimes you go to church and then you do these things in the secret. God has been giving you grace, but do not frustrate it, because it will come to a point where God will let you to a reprobate mind, which means you have frustrated the grace of God. Number two, we have limited grace. That is to say, people can limit the grace of God. People can minimize the grace of God. People can contain the grace of God. Just like they are saying today, containing coronavirus, containing it, COVID-19, containing it, trying to minimize it, trying to stop it, trying to do things that will prevent it from spreading. This is what some people have done to the grace of God. One example is Samson. Samson, God showered grace upon. Samson will be sleeping. Samson, the Philistines are upon you. Bam, he will get up and then he will decimate all of them. He will finish all of them. Samson will pick up a jawbone and he will use it to kill one people. Samson will pull out a heavy gate and use it to kill people, climb up to the mountain with it and kill people. He took it for granted. God, this grace would have extended. This grace was to deliver Israel, but he frustrated. He couldn't deliver Israel. In fact, he couldn't maximize that grace. He eventually died. In fact, when he died, Judges chapter 15 verse 20, the Bible said the Philistines still ruled the land. And this was the reason why God brought him on board, that he might deliver Israel from the Philistines. But Samson fell. He couldn't maximize that grace. The reason for which that grace was given could not be maximized. He died, and yet he could not fulfill his mission here on earth. There's another person we can cite an example. First, in 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 3, verse 4, and verse 9, you see the story of Solomon. Solomon started very well. He performed excellently well. His performance was exquisite. Somebody would say, this kind of wisdom we have not seen anywhere. God granted him wisdom, granted him grace, granted him wealth, granted him favor, granted him everything. In fact, the Bible said he had rest every side. His father fought all the battles in his own time. He had rest every side. There was no battle. And you know, one of the things that can hinder achievement is battles. When you have too much battles, you will not concentrate, you will not have the resources, you will not have what it takes to achieve anything. So his father could not build for God, but he had rest everywhere, and so had every opportunity, but he contained that grace because of strange women. Anywhere he saw a woman, he would carry. He married 700 wives, 300 concubines. The Bible concluded, if you refer to 1 Kings chapter 11, 29 to 30, that they stole his heart away from God. So he started well, but could not end well. So that grace was contained, was minimized, was inhibited. He could not maximize it. He could not make the maximum impact that he was supposed to make. Number three, grace can be maximized. Grace can be maximized. And that is where I'm trafficking to, and that is what I want God to do in my life and in your life, that grace can be maximized. And Paul was a typical, in fact, a classical example of those who maximize the grace of God in their lives. The place we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10, he said, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am today." Ebubele. "And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain." He maximized it. Paul wrote 1/3 of the New Testament. Paul was the last comer as long as the apostles were concerned, but he overtook all of them. None of them saw his brake light. Paul maximized the grace of God in his life. Why was he able to maximize it? There are about four reasons. Number one, he was truly converted to Christ. There can be no maximization of grace when somebody is living in sin or when somebody is not a child of God. Number two, he was totally committed to Christ right from his conversion. So commitment has a way of stirring up the grace of God that is in you. He was never half-hearted in his devotion to Christ, but he was fully persuaded. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12. He was fully persuaded in what he was doing, and so the grace of God was maximized in his life. Number three, he purified himself. Purified himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. He said he purified himself of all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. So he walked in holiness all the days of his life, knowing that sin will easily frustrate the grace of God in his life, just like we saw in Hebrews chapter 12, 14 to 17, in the life of Esau. So he lived a holy life. There is nothing that ignites grace, that there's nothing that makes grace to have expression like a holy life. When you live a holy life, just like I said the other time, that the purer the copper, the better it conducts electricity. When the copper is pure, it conducts electricity more. So when you live a holy life, you have prepared yourself a vessel of honor, sanctified, made for the master's use, and the grace of God can be maximized in your life. That was why I was saying a few days ago that some people today come to stage to perform, but they are making noise. We know those people who are spiritual know it is noise they are making, because they just think it's all about talent. But when the grace of God is upon your life, wow, even without noise, you see maximum impact. So he lived a holy life. He prepared himself a vessel where this grace can flow from. And number four, he was very diligent in his work with God. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10. So diligent with his work, with God. He was diligent in fasting and prayer. This kind of grace, amplified grace. He fed into a shameful sin, terrible sin. A prophet of God confronted him on that. He truly humbled himself and repented genuinely and turned to God. If you read the book of Psalm 51, you see his prayers of repentance concerning that sin. God heard his cries, forgave him, and still called him a man after his heart. Ebubele. In Acts chapter 13, verse 23, God called him David, a man after my heart. And the Bible said, and after David had served his generation, he slept with his fathers. That today, I remember a few years ago, Israel celebrated 3,000 years of the demise of David. 3,000 years of the demise of David. If you go to Israel, one of the places they will take you to is the tomb of David. And to tell you how they respect David, you cannot enter there without covering your head. They will give you a cap to cover your head because they still respect him. More than 3,000 years he died for you to enter his tomb. David became a celebrated person, both in Israel. Till today, he is a man that is respected and celebrated. David had grace that was amplified grace. You need this kind of grace. In fact, this level, there are just few people who are operating in this level of grace. Just little effort, amplified results. Sometimes they don't need to braid their hair. They don't swear to get what they want. This is the grace I have been praying for. This is the grace that you need in your life. Grace can be maximized, but there is another level called amplified grace. I don't know if you understand what I'm talking about. If you are talking to a congregation of 5,000 without a microphone, you will stress yourself. You will strain your voice, and yet they will not still hear you. You will lose strength. You'll be gasping for breath. You'll be losing energy. But just pick up a microphone. You don't need to shout. With an amplifier, your voice, bam, is magnified, and everybody hears you loud and clear. That is what amplified grace does in the life of somebody. When this grace comes upon your life, my dear brother and sister, your business will be amplified. You don't need to make too much noise. You might even be in a hidden place. You see people looking for you in that place. It's not all about location, as I said before, but all about connection. This grace will connect you. When this grace comes upon your life, amplified grace, you are a preacher. Oh, you don't need to break your head. You see people thronging on you for programs. You are the one that will be rejecting programs. I was telling somebody some time ago, I said, you don't need to break your head for programs. Some time ago, God told me, do not go for program again. Seek my face. When you find me, program will come seeking for you. People were complaining that time. It's like he has become proud. You know, he's making gain. He doesn't want to accept programs and all that. Even some of my friends were calling me, this is what people are saying. I said, they will not understand until I was done with that prayer. And then programs, people, you know, sorry, I don't have time. You will not be booked a year, 2 years ahead. Are you talented in singing or whatever? You need amplified grace. There are some people, you listen to their song, you wonder why everybody is running after this song. There are others that have better voice, you know, better packaging, and yet nobody is talking about them. All you need is amplified grace. That's what you need. When this grace comes upon your life, you don't need to struggle for anything again. There are a few who are operating in that level. I hear them, some men of God, they will say, I don't pray for money. Money comes looking for them. You can imagine, some time ago I went to sow a seed in the life of a man of God. I had to take a flight to that city. I had to enter into a hotel to stay for a few days, to ensure that I saw him. I had to wait. Program was over. I waited. Everybody left. Waited till 10 p.m. until after 10 p.m. when he was not coming down from the upstairs. And then I had to rush, block his way, and just to beg him to take a seat for me. You can imagine that kind of grace. That is called amplified grace. Whereas there are people who are begging for money. There are people right now, even online, using, you know, palliative to beg money, using coronavirus to beg money, begging money from people. But there are others who sit in a place and people come with Ghana Must Go with money, begging them to collect the money, begging them to queue into their program, begging them to sponsor their program. That is amplified grace. That is where you need to get to. When amplified grace comes, struggles end in your life. This is the level I desire. This is the level I know you are desiring. That God will not just move you to maximization of grace, but to this level called amplified grace. Barado Shikaraya. I pray that this grace will rest upon your life right now. Wherever you are watching me from, let this grace rest upon you in the name of Jesus Christ. You are praying for your documentation. This is just the grace you need. When this grace comes, it doesn't matter how many that have been on the queue before you. They say, this thing will take 5-6 years for it to reach your turn. No, you just be surprised. Within a month or two, you submitted it, they will give you a call, because this kind of grace defies protocols. Amplified grace, that is what you need. One of my sons was going, in fact, he sowed a seed one day in my life, and I spoke into his life. That money was money he was going to use to take jam. I haven't seen that kind of sacrifice before. He could pick the money. I think far back it was 10,000 naira given to him by his parents. His parents were in the service that day. When I called for that seed, he came and brought that seed. And when he said, "This is for my jam," as I picked that money, I said, "Hey, this school, you will not do it in Nigeria. You will do it in Europe. You do it abroad." Everybody thought it was a joke. He applied for a school in Europe. That day they went to the embassy. The embassy locked their gate. They said they are not seeing anybody that day. The people crowded at the gate. After an hour, a white man walked out from the embassy, came to the gate. He said, you, pointed at three persons, and he was among those three people. He opened the gate and said, "Come in, please. Others, go." Ebubele. As they walked in, he had no, statement of account, which was the most important thing they needed. He didn't have certain things they needed. But as he stood before that young man, the interviewer looked at him after some time. He said, "Hey, my friend, you are not qualified for visa, but something is telling me to give you visa." Ebubele, he just gave him a visa, and he traveled to Europe and started studying medicine. This is called amplified grace. That is the grace I am speaking into your life right now. Wherever you are watching me, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, I command that this grace will rest upon your life now. Receive it in the name of Jesus. May this grace terminate struggle in your academies. May this grace terminate struggle in that project you are writing. May this grace terminate struggle in that contract you are doing. May this grace terminate struggle in that your business. May this grace terminate struggle in that your work. May this grace terminate struggle in that your talent. You have struggled and struggled. You can't come to the limelight. May this grace speak for you from now. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, my friend, if you have not given your life to Jesus, I'd like to pray for you right now. If only you can say, "Jesus, here am I, forgive my sins and come into my life." That way you will no longer frustrate the grace of God that is made available unto you. Bow your heads and say this prayer with me right now. Say, "Lord Jesus, I'm so sorry for my sins. Please forgive me. Come into my life today and be my Lord and Savior. I denounce sin and Satan, and I declare for Jesus today, in Jesus' name. Amen." All right, I pray that it shall be unto you as you have confessed, in Jesus' name. May powers of sin be destroyed in your life. Receive the power to live for God today, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you are sick, I rebuke that sickness. to pack its load and get out of your body right now in the name of Jesus. From your head to the sole of your feet, be made whole. No matter the name of that sickness, at the name of Jesus, every knee must bow. So pack and go now. And let there be healing, let there be freedom, let there be restoration of health. Let there be healing of that wound right now. In Jesus' name, you need the fruit of the womb. I release this amplified grace to rest upon you now. That in the next 2 months, 3 months, you will become pregnant. You will impregnate your wife. The story will change in the name of Jesus Christ. Every kind of frustration in your life, I terminate it right now. Every kind of struggle, I terminate it right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, I bring the protective shell of God over you today. Lord, shall be with you going out and you're coming in. You will have no business with coronavirus. You will not have no business with the attack of the enemy, terrorism of any kind, accident of any kind. No weapon fashioned against you this week shall prosper in the name of Jesus Christ. God shall favor you. When people are suffering, your case will be different. When people are lacking, your case will be different. You shall lack nothing good in the name of Jesus Christ. God shall prove He is your shepherd. He will supply all your needs according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Today I release extraordinary favor upon you in Jesus' name. I pray that the Lord will cause His face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. I bless you today in the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let me hear your loudest amen and amen. All right. I hope you are blessed today. I'll be with you again in the evening. That's 6 p.m. today. Join me again for Atmosphere of Possibilities. And I'll be coming up again to the use of God to be a blessing to you. The account details are right there on the screen. If you want to pay your tithe or sow a seed or give your offering, this is like a service. Go ahead and give your offering using the account details. And then you want me to pray and cancel with you, can call me right now on that number on the screen, +234 803 4095 171. Until I come your way again this evening. And then tomorrow morning, this is your brother, Reverend Better Wannabe, Reverend B, saying, God bless you.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance.